Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us here in Taipei for this year's Assembly of Presidents. And I hope you'll find it a productive experience. The Assembly is always different for everyone you meet because there are different things going on and people fill in the gaps with their own programs. So please make the most of it. Take advantage of the networking opportunities and we appreciate your role in making it a successful event. I usually start by trying to give some sense of the state of the industry. We have just released the September traffic figures for Asian Airlines. And those show that in September, international passenger numbers were up 5.6%. And RPK growth is faster at 7.5%, which tells us that long-haul travel markets are continuing to remain robust. And the load factor was half a percentage point higher as seat capacity grew by 6.8%. If we look at the first 9 months, in RPK terms, the business has grown 7.9%, which is obviously above trend. And that's, I'll show some graphs tomorrow, but the passenger growth has been relentless. And over the last 5 years, rather above the normal trend, partly stimulated by the fact that oil prices have fallen, which gets translated into lower fares. Even when oil prices were high, airfares were affordable enough that we saw continued growth in numbers. But I do think there has been a boost to passenger demand from the fact that airfares have adjusted downwards as fuel prices adjusted, and that makes air travel clearly affordable to record numbers of people. On the cargo side, you remember we've had some very difficult years since the global financial crisis was followed by a rebound in 2010 after the slump of the previous year. And then we had several years of relatively stagnant markets, which were very tough times for cargo operators, particularly pure freighter operators. Now, during that time, it has to be said that the industry continues to do what it does well, which is carry a lot of very valuable and time-sensitive goods. The statistics. Airlines carry about 35% of the value of global trade. The goods are worth about $6 trillion. It's less than 1% of the tonnage of international trade, but it's 35% of the value. And the importance of that to the global economy was it was just as important during the relatively slow growth days of recent years. The customers are still getting the value that comes from shifting those high value items, keeping supply chains moving. Now, having said that, it was a fairly thankless task operating freighters during that time. Most operators cut back on capacity to the point where they tried to break even on their freighter operations and wait for better times. A number of freighters were parked. More and more belly capacity was coming to the marketplace, so that kept postponing the recovery in demand for pure freighters. But in the middle of 2016, the global economy was doing okay, but we started to see trade pick up slightly. And when trade picks up, air cargo tends to pick up a little more quickly because air freight is one of the faster means of replenishing stocks for retailers and business supply chains. So then we started seeing traffic for cargo numbers reported in the second half of 2016 showing significant growth. And that momentum continued into this year. And this year we've seen double-digit growth. So for the first 9 months, Asian Airlines have seen 10.7% increase in cargo traffic measured in FTKs. Now, because 2016 was a game of two halves, a rather lackluster first half with zero to slightly negative growth and a relatively strong recovery in the second half, when we get into 2017, the first half is comparing to a weak first half 2016, and the second half of 2017 is comparing to a relatively strong 2016. So that leads you to think that we should expect the monthly growth rates reported, not the volumes to fall, but the growth reported on the base effect will come down, but it hasn't. So that is a positive surprise. we're still seeing double digit, same month last year, double digit growth. So that's very welcome. It's led to freighter utilization improving and moving back towards profitability. And obviously that's encouraging. It also says positive things about the state of the global economy. So that's as we see it. And of course Asian Airlines carry almost 40% of global air cargo total. So what we see is reflective of the global picture. I should clarify, it's not purely an Asian export story. European exports are strong. European carriers have been seeing the same growth in cargo. And there are some big cargo operators amongst the European carriers and also the Gulf carriers. So it's a global picture that says something positive about the state of the global economy, that trade has picked up a bit, and that momentum is being continued. Consumer confidence is positive. So record numbers of passengers and cargo improving again. The challenge is, how are airlines doing in terms of bottom line performance? Fuel prices basically bottomed out in the 50s in 2016, but they've recovered fairly significantly into the mid 60s. So the trend where the fares declined has to reverse as the effect of higher oil prices feeds back in. And that wasn't evident in the first half of this year. We still saw continued yield declines for Asian Airlines for passenger yields. Cargo yields were up a few percent in the first half. But the passenger yields were still declining. And that accounts for the commentary you'll see from airline CEOs in Asia, often talking about intensely competitive markets, margins under pressure, despite the fact that passenger growth is continuing and things seem to be on a positive trend. The most recent evidence is that yields have started to turn, as is natural. And IATA were forecasting profits this year for Asian Airlines of about $7 billion, which is similar to the results for Asian Airlines in 2016 or 2015. And I saw no reason to take a different view. But I have to say there's a degree of uncertainty because the results so far this year for individual airlines have been rather patchy, some doing better than others. And we're talking about a relatively small number in a very large revenue business. And we're not in the habit of making profit forecasts anyway. We leave that to IATA and others, the many analysts who follow the industry. So overall profitability for the industry is healthy for the last 3 years. Some have done better than others. You know the story. The US carriers have had a very good period of strong profits. The number of reasons for that, mature, low growth market. Naturally disciplined capacity management because of the low growth environment, and their cost structures are competitive, many of them having been through bankruptcy restructuring. And so it's the US carriers who've been accounting for half of the profit pool in some good years for the industry, and that trend continues in 2016 and is expected to be the case also in 2017. Overall, however, IATA's forecast for this year is about $31 billion. The number of passengers last year was 3.8 billion globally. It'll probably reach, surpass 4 billion this year. So you do the maths, it's $8 a passenger in a reasonably good year. That's a margin of about 4%. And if you drill down into how the US carriers, how European carriers, how Asian carriers are doing again, the margins for, on average, in Europe and Asia are lower than they are in the States. And this competitive nature of the market seems to be across the board, no matter which business model you're following, short haul, long haul, which single service, multiple classes of service. Premium traffic seems to be in good demand. Those airlines that offer multiple classes of service are investing in upgrading those products and deploying them. We're seeing more airlines launching premium economy, and the LCC sector is also still growing rapidly. But we do need to keep a sense of proportion, and I'll discuss some overall figures tomorrow, trying to capture what is the state of the market in terms of business models. One of the difficulties there, as you know, is that the business models are converging and hybridizing, whatever phrase you want to use, and it's really a labeling exercise as to how you describe carriers. But having with that caveat, the basic point is that the full service network carrier model still captures the lion's share of the revenue globally and region by region, notwithstanding the faster growth of the LCC segment. And with a number of LCCs now launching long-haul low-cost operations, and others are launching similar activities, their business model has to morph even more into a connected network model, because long-haul operations don't seem to thrive on a standalone basis, and they seem to be dependent on having feed. And that's best provided within the context of an airline group structure, or even a single airline that operates both. Looking ahead, the global economy, the IMF World Bank meetings in Washington last week, the mood was positive, because the forecasts are that this year is a bit faster than last year, and next year is a bit faster than this year. We're talking decimal points, 3 point something. But there's a general feeling that if you look around the world, most economies are growing, most economies are doing slightly better than they were, and there are far fewer negative cases than we saw in previous years. So the general mood is things are in pretty good shape, the global economy is in pretty good shape, and that augurs well for the next 12 months. Longer term, the growth prospects for Asia remain very bright. Asian markets, Asian airlines already account for a third of global passengers. And over the next 20 years, the projections are Asian airlines will account for about 38% of the total traffic 20 years from now. And that market will be 2 and a bit times bigger than today overall on a global basis. So that's an awful lot of growth to come. That brings challenges. We need infrastructure, you've heard me say it, and it remains a very popular theme. A lot of airport capacity is being built, we appreciate that. New runways, new terminals, new investments, new connecting ground transport systems. But still, you can point to areas where it's too little too late, and we'll be calling on governments again to focus on long-term infrastructure planning. And it's not just airports and runways and terminals. On the air traffic management side, which is also part of infrastructure, less visible to the public, of course, airspace congestion is evident in many areas and regions around Asia, and as the rest of the world, for that matter. But let's focus on Asia. So airspace modernization has to keep pace with the rapid growth in traffic. And airspace management tends to fall into national blocks with different national service aeronautical service providers. But from an airline point of view, we want seamless skies and integrated flow management. And the big challenge in Asia is that modernizing air traffic management is not a question of each state modernizing its own air traffic management system. The benefits come from closer collaboration between managers of airspace in different, above different regions, countries, interacting with each other. And from the airline's point of view and from the passenger's point of view, you essentially want integrated management of airspace and flow control. Now in Europe, that function is focused through Eurocontrol. In America, it's done, all my airspace is managed by FAA, so it's done by FAA on an integrated basis with specific flow management techniques. The challenge in Asia and some other regions where you don't have these centralized flow control bodies is we have to achieve the benefits of flow management across the region but with distributed responsibility and distributed decision making. And you have to apply the technologies and overlay it with the institutional arrangements and the operational practices to deliver the results. And a lot of highly technical work has been going on, and we applaud those efforts and urge governments to continue to think beyond national borders and focus on improving the effectiveness of air traffic management flows across the region. The other thing about future growth is the growth has to be sustainable. You've heard me talk before about how committed the industry is to sustainable development, and that includes environmental sustainability. And we have a four-pillar strategy, let's call it a multi-pillar strategy. Fuel efficiency is a relentless aim. Operational infrastructure improvements. There's some interesting work going on with sustainable alternative fuels. And of course, we spent years of negotiating with governments, or governments negotiating with each other more accurately, culminating in the agreement at the ICAO Assembly last year to implement a carbon offsetting scheme for international aviation, now known as CORSIA. Despite the number of years it took to reach a successful conclusion, that agreement was simply to implement a scheme called CORSIA. Doing that requires an immense amount of technical work. Within ICAO, governments and working groups, which combine government experts and industry experts, are working to turn a CORSIA into an implementable scheme. That means preparing technical documents which will be approved by the ICAO Council in 2018, which will then pave the way for individual national governments to implement national legislation which will bring CORSIA into existence. The timetable is tight. 2019, January onwards, all airlines will have to report all international emissions, which means the systems for airlines have to be in place by the end of 2018. So those are the current twin deadlines which are pressuring the players. You've got ICAO, governments at ICAO, individual governments, national legislation, and airlines. This is not sequential, it's all in parallel. The reporting starts in 2019 and applies to all airlines. You may have heard that participation in CORSIA by states is on a voluntary basis in the initial years. I think 72 states have signed up, representing well over 80% of international emissions. The point to emphasize is that even for those states that have not volunteered for the initial phase, the reporting obligations fall on all airlines from all states. So the current pressure on 2018-2019 is much wider than simply the people who volunteered early. That's a point that bears emphasizing, because it's not universally understood. The actual offsetting obligations are calculated from the end of 2020 onwards. It starts in 2021, and from that date, airlines will have to purchase carbon offsets in accordance with CORSIA requirements. So 2021 seems like a long way away, but 2018 seems very close. And that accounts for the fact that there is a lot of pressure to turn that scheme into reality. And we urge governments to press on with those efforts, and airlines are keen to implement their side of the reporting requirements as required. I'll just touch on a few other regulatory issues: safety, security, taxes and charges relate to the fact we've got a lot of infrastructure. The airline industry and customers do pay for the infrastructure, but it comes in, has to be financed in advance, and a lot of that capex is very significant. So there are some discussions to be had about taxes and charges and financing of infrastructure, but I won't dwell on that for now. Just on safety, we never tire of saying it's always the number one priority. The industry's never been safer. The industry's demonstrated continuous improvements in safety performance year by year, And there have been dramatic improvements in safety performance, demonstrable in the statistics and the accident loss rates. And that's a remarkable achievement for everybody in the industry, including manufacturers, airports, airlines, staff, regulators. It's a collective success story, it seems to be continuing on its positive downward trend in terms of the loss rates. So, and again, that is a global phenomenon. The Asian results are in line with the global results. What it tells us is that the safety culture and safety management systems and their effectiveness has now spread throughout the world. There used to be much more visible differences in performance, safety performance between different regions. But what's clear now from the overall quality of safety performance of the industry, it has spread, you know, globally. Again, that's a remarkable achievement. On security, I wish it was such a happy story. The good news is flying is very secure, both against threats of theft and general security and well-being, as well as against terrorist threats or other unlawful interference. But the security and security processes always rank amongst the least pleasant parts of the travel experience, according to passengers. And this year we have seen a number of initiatives which have further complicated life for passengers going through airport security. You'll remember the laptop ban, the operating portable electronic devices being banned on specific flights from specific airports into the United States. That was superseded after a lot of international and intergovernmental and industry government interaction. Those requirements were lifted by the United States, but in their place they introduced new measures applying to all flights into the United States from all overseas airports. And that has had a very significant impact on security processes in those airports. And it has also triggered a number of similar, sometimes slightly different measures by a number of other governments and regulators. What does that mean from a passenger point of view? It means that security is now destination specific. That makes life difficult for airlines, airports, and passengers. It means that airport processes have to be segregated. Central screening doesn't meet the requirements. So it means more gate screening, more segregated screening, more double screening. So there's additional time and effort and cost being layered onto the system. If other countries take a similar approach and impose destination-specific requirements, that compounds the problem. And you may have heard recently that China has announced some new restrictions on a selective basis on inbound flights from certain countries. And a number of other countries have implemented quietly without official announcement, but in conjunction with the industry through giving instructions, they've introduced additional measures which may or may not be evident to customers. So we have spent a fair amount of time this year on working on security-related issues, even when the US laptop ban applied only to selected operators and airports, mostly in the Middle East. We were conscious of the fact that it might spread, and indeed there were fears that it would spread to airports in Europe, and so we were engaged in that those discussions from an early stage. And the fact is that aviation security is a global concern, and we need a global dialogue and approach. And the best forum for that is ICAO, which is an intergovernmental body. And ICAO is formulating a global aviation security plan. They have basically it's a long-term roadmap. They have a global air navigation plan, they have a global air safety plan, and they're developing a global aviation security plan to try to provide global guidance on the way forward and setting priorities. And our other plea is that it's not just a matter of governments getting together. There's a big role for industry, that includes airports as well as airlines, in discussing with governments what aviation security measures, how would they be most effective, because we're the ones who have to implement it, and thinking about that beforehand rather than after the fact is beneficial. And I talked about the safety performance of the industry, for which everyone deserves credit. The lesson from improving safety performance was everyone works together, and there is a lot of thought goes in before initiatives are taken, and there's a lot of cost-benefit analysis goes on before safety initiatives are embedded in the system. And you see far more measured decision-making, you see far fewer reversals of policy, and you see far more harmonization of approaches across the world. So we would hope that some of those good practices and cultures might usefully be transferred across from the safety regime to the aviation security policy setting regime. I'm afraid too often aviation security is a knee-jerk reaction to some incident. So aviation security has been a big talking point. There have been a couple of big conferences, another one coming up next month. And these are the kind of themes you'll hear talked about. Probably enough from me. Looking forward to some questions. Yes, Tom.
I'm sure you saw the Australian government just announced stronger measures to screen airport workers, people who work airside, the thousands of people who work airside. How much of a concern is that amongst airlines across the region that the people who actually work airside aren't screened enough?
Yeah, in the parlance, it's insider threats. It's people with access, staff members, tenants, people with access. So airports are very complex businesses with tens of thousands of passengers at an airport, maybe more, and thousands of staff. So we focus a lot on the passenger screening process, but you have to screen and have access control to anybody who goes anywhere near the airport, particularly if they have access to sterile areas, whether that's within the terminal or on the ramp, or in the hangar or the cargo terminal. So there are well-established protocols on how to do that, and that includes background checks on staff.
It seems incredible to me that I'm not sure how common this is around the region, but in Australia, airport staff, when they go to work, don't go through the same sort of screening that passengers do. They don't go through metal detectors or bomb detector or whatever. Should that be introduced on a widespread basis?
It's a combination of two things. So one is the background checks on the employees, badging of employees, and the use of badges to control who can go where. And the use of locked doors and badge control systems if you open it, and so on. Or inspection by security guards to check badges, either 100% or on a random basis. In addition, you can screen employees. And in some places, employees are subject to screening. What I'm saying applies to cargo warehouses, hangars, and so on. Other people with access to sensitive areas, operational areas related to airports. Different jurisdictions put more emphasis on screening of staff. They may use a separate entrance, but they're being screened or subject to screening. But in other places, there's more emphasis on the background checks and making sure those are up to date in terms of any untoward behavior or criminal records or whatever, and using the badge control system, but not physically. So it's a mixture. Those who favor one try and lecture the others on how they should do it. But overall, it's well established. Can it be improved? Yes. So you have to think on the insider threat, you have to think in terms of penetration. If someone tries to penetrate, become an employee, and so on and so forth. So you've got to think about that.
Because I guess some would ask, it'd be curious that, say, a, a pilot would have to be security screened to get through to airside, but a baggage handler may not necessarily have to be, just in the way that the security system is set up. Some would call it curious.
Yeah, well, the passengers and cabin crew tend to be processed through the passenger terminal and go through the same, although they may, in the US, they were granted TSA pre-check, so they go through a lighter check, as do some passengers. But you have to look at the different kinds of people who work. Catering workers, they may be going back and forth between off-site, on-site. Truck access is another issue, not just people. How do you search trucks, et cetera, et cetera. So, I mean, airports are like mini cities. So when you talk about security of an airport, it's multidimensional. So you have to use a variety of things. And yes, things can always be improved. So the Australian initiative is just something on that.
Andy, I just wanted to ask you, going back to that, I mean, do you have a position on this? Does the AAPA at this stage have a position about what they would prefer in terms of such situations of airside screening staff that aren't going through the process of the passenger clearance as a result of all your discussions this year? Do you have a formula or a position?
No, this is well covered by ICAO standards and guidelines, and the, you know, you can meet the requirements through a variety of methods, but you have to do it in a way that is up to standard. It's not the method. Often there's, you know, you're focusing on outcomes. There's different ways of achieving the outcome. And you have to measure how well it's done. It's not a question of saying this is the only way to do it. There are some cases where the guidelines just say you have to do this. But in other cases, it varies. And in the case of staff, I mean, part of it is, what do you do about imposters? Do you challenge people? What control do you have over the badges? What happens when staff leave? You know, there's a lot of issues to be addressed in terms of improving the quality or assessing the quality with which it's been done. So I'd only be fair to say we have a strong preference for one or the other. US tends to favor one approach. Europe, it's something different. In Asia, it varies. But regardless of the method you use, you have to apply it faithfully and get the outcome you want. And airports are very secure places. You know, air cargo, one of the reasons people ship high-value air cargo is air cargo and air travel is highly secure against interference, usually criminal interference, not terrorist interference. So the physical security and the threat of insiders involved in criminal activity, smuggling or theft or whatever, those are issues that, you know, we're conscious of, as opposed to the terrorist threat, which is a separate set of thoughts. What's the sequence? Can you play? Yes, go on.
Andy, you mentioned that yields are still depressed in the first half of the year, but you're seeing them start to turn. I'm just wondering if you could talk to that a little bit more. And also, is that partly an effect of some of the fuel surcharges kicking back in again?
You're talking passenger?
Yeah, passenger.
Well, for Asian Airlines, the yields were still down a few percent the first half. If you look at the U.S. carrier results, they were up a bit. But if you look at the U.S. carrier divisional global regional breakdown, they were seeing the yield pressure on the Pacific, consistent with what we're seeing. But their domestic yields were slightly up. Now, more recently, there's been some stories about United and yield pressure and price discounting and so on, and I don't know what the latest is on the yields, but the general trend was they seemed to hang on to the yields a bit longer. We were seeing a lot of yield pressure in our markets and across the Pacific. They were seeing the same thing on the Pacific. But the most recent IATA Airline Financial Monitor monthly, I saw just a slight uptick in the passenger yield. So now, whether that's a price increase, removal of lower fares, just the mix changing, or whether it's a fuel surcharge, this is just presentation, to be honest. Some people have fuel surcharges, others don't. I mean, it all goes into the fare cost, the ticket price. And we're talking small variations here, but you can't go from fuel at 53 to 63, which is, what, $10, 20% fuel increase. That's a few percent higher cost in the fare. So you'd expect it to see. So when things go down, it goes down. So you'd expect to see it. My sense is that quite a few CEOs got tired of waiting for it, because when the fuel price falls, the fares tend to fall very quickly. And when the fuel price turns, there's often a feeling of when are the fares going to recover. As I say, lower fares don't go down when you announce, don't go up when you announce fare increases. They go down when the cheaper fares you've had out in the marketplace get depleted and the mix slightly improves. And you don't know till afterwards. So that's just my sense.
Yeah. It's what you were seeing in the IATA financial monitor. That sort of corresponds with what you're sort of hearing anecdotally from CEOs and around that issue.
Well, to be honest, we don't talk to CEOs about yields and pricing. These are off limits. So we're always looking at it from the point of view of aggregate data and just trying to interpret. Not entirely aggregate data, but de-identified data, just sensing what's happening in the marketplace. The main lesson is the market is very competitive. It disciplines everybody in it, and that's the way it works. That's the way capitalism works. Yes, Karen.
Yeah, Andrew, so just going back to security, obviously with these numbers, passenger traffic's still growing. So it's not putting off the passengers in this area. But what are you hearing from the airlines here, your member airlines, in terms of the additional hassle, etc., and costs that they're having to burn? That, you know, are they having to allow longer time for, you know, more advanced time for people to get through to get to the boarding area, etc.?
Yeah, I mean, it comes down to the specifics, and one has to be careful because some of this is sensitive information and so on. But without straying into those areas, essentially what the US requirements mean is that you have to provide pre-check-in screening of passengers, and that may involve interviewing passengers, and that involves training a lot of frontline staff, either your own or an appointed agent, to carry out such activities. And that's a training burden and a cost and an activity cost which may not have been there before. The next thing is that it calls for increased scrutiny of electronic devices and increased usage of explosive trace detection equipment or sniffer dogs in some cases. And that's additional work and additional manpower. Again, who provides it? Who pays for it? Is it the airline? Is it an agent? Is it airline staff? Is it an agency? Is it the airport? Is it an agency employed by the airport? Is it the government? It doesn't matter. It has to be done, and it's additional cost. Who pays the cost is ultimately it'll have to be the passenger. But it may take a while before it works its way through the parcel as to who's bearing the cost. And our concern is that people very rarely sit down and work out what the overall costs of security are. If they did, they might not embark on some of these initiatives. They'd question the cost-benefit analysis, which is what we do with safety all the time. But that isn't usually the way of approaching security. So I don't think the costs have been estimated, but it's significant. And meeting the deadlines puts further pressure on because you've got to meet a training timetable within a deadline, which adds to the cost because you've got to hurry and mobilize additional, you know, we know that. The other thing is that it requires additional screening at the gate because if it only applies to passengers to that destination and you're intermingling with passengers in the rest of the airport, that doesn't work. So a lot of these new requirements have to be done at the gate. Now, for airports that use centralized screening, that's a major problem because the centralized screening is done. Now you have to implement gate screening on a flight-specific basis. And that means finding space, room for the equipment, people to operate it. You have to select passengers from the flight to be subject to such screening. It may not be 100%. Might be 10 people, 20 people, 40 people, whatever. They've got to be identified, channeled, subject to that additional screening, signed off, allowed to board. So you're right. When you factor this in, the amount of time you need at the gate, the space you need at the gate, how long you need to keep the gate allocated for that flight is impacted, and your potential on-time performance and the efficiency of utilization of gates at the airport, all of these are threatened. We learned this from listening to people who had to implement the laptop ban, who had to implement similar, in that case it was inspecting and removing from passengers these items. And they talked about the fact that, you know, they went from what would have taken, allow 60 minutes, you know, you're allowing 90 minutes, so having to block the gate for 2 hours and so on and so forth. So you're right, but our focus, airlines aren't focused on those issues right now. It's just make it happen, make sure it meets the requirements, yeah, and then think about trying to do it more efficiently. But it's a big burden because it impacts all inbound flights from all airports into the United States. And that's before anybody else gets the idea, well, if it's good for that, why not the other way around, or what about this, or what about that? So yeah, it's churlish to talk about cost when we're talking about security, but we do on safety all the time. It's not safety at any price, it's safety, you know, fantastic levels of safety and safety improvements with the money being spent in the place which will do the best in terms of safety outcome. You can always think of a lot of things that get to do. On security, we don't prioritize, we don't filter according to which is the most effective, which is the pays off the best. As for the customers, the passengers, you're right, they're long suffering. They know it's for their own benefit. They keep telling themselves they put up with it. And in some cases, security is done pretty well. It works smoothly. People are used to the routines. They go through it. But there are other cases where it doesn't. The procedures may be the same, but the feeling is entirely different and the consumers don't like it. And our job is to try and engineer it that you get more people getting the better experience. So point to examples where it's done well and criticize examples where it's done badly. And if you think it's tough now, imagine, you know, with another 10% more passengers, another 20% more passengers. So the question is it scalable? Is it sustainable? Is it scalable?
I have two questions. So on the subject of security, does AAPA have a stance on the right to carry a laptop onto a flight? If so, what is that stance? And on decongestion in the air, what is it that the association or member airlines can do to help or to encourage China to do more than it's doing? Thanks.
So laptops in the cabin and China airspace. Laptops in the cabin, people can't live without their phones, they can't live without their devices. They expect to have them with them. There's a big discussion about they expect to be connected in the air, which is technically possible in some areas of the world, particularly over land, more challenging over the ocean, although the latest satellite constellations are now coming in on stream, and there are a number of transoceanic solutions for in-flight connectivity. The assessment is that laptops in the cabin are fine. There was a lot of discussion about whether they could be used during takeoff. There's concern about large, heavy devices being thrown around the cabin in case of turbulence, particularly. And so most airlines have a restriction of usage in terms of climb and descent for tablets or laptops, but not for phones. Most people now allow gate-to-gate usage. These are based on long safety assessments of electromagnetic interference, fire hazards. There are protocols for what do you do if a laptop or something becomes overheats and smokes and so on. I mean, those are runaway heat examples with batteries. The issues in the hold are more significant. So most airlines have restrictions on carrying spare batteries in the hold. Batteries in devices are generally thought to be low risk, but spare batteries that may short or badly packed, and particularly spare batteries that are in more than you'd need for yourself, I mean shipping quantities and so on, there are serious concerns, and a lot of discussion about the shipment of pallets of electronic devices, pallets of batteries and so on. There's a lot of discussion and restrictions on those, which aircraft can they fly, etc., etc. A lot of discussion about packaging that might improve the resilience of those to thermal runaway events for if one battery doesn't then cascade across, etc. So basically devices in the cabin, that was basically a false alarm. That was the threat of artfully concealed explosives terrorist threat. most recent thing, as I say, is the FAA has now joined EASA in saying, pointing to the safety hazard of putting electronic devices in the hold baggage, because if it does overheat, you can't attend to it. In the cabin, you can attend to it, isolate it, but in the hold. On the other hand, you've got to assess what's the probabilities, what's the number of devices, is a complete ban the right answer? That'll be one of the discussion items within ICAO. On China airspace, Chinese market is now huge. It's a real challenge. They've built airports as fast as they can. They have modern air traffic control equipment. They're very serious about the work they do and the challenges they face. There is still this issue in any country between the civil-military balance. A lot of airspace is allocated to military use. Civil requirements keep growing, so you know, there's a conversation to be had about, can you have more allocation to civil, can you have flexible use of airspace, and so on. The other issue, in China you've got the airspace congestion, but you've also got very heavily utilized major hub airports. So you have the route congestion, but you also have the terminal congestion around airports, around the big hub airports. So there's currently a consultation underway on revising slot management techniques in China, and you know, they're constantly striving to try and improve the efficiency of airspace in terms of separations, procedures, and so on and so forth. So industry's supportive of encouraging, you know, further initiatives. It's a conservative culture in CATM, Air Traffic Management Bureau. Safety is always your main concern with managing airspace. Remember, airspace management is people on the ground controlling aircraft. It's a very old-fashioned, using traditional communication, it's a very old-fashioned control system. People like Google and Amazon come along and say, no, what you need is autonomous flight and pilotless airplanes and automated systems. But that's not what you have. You have mixed-use airspace, big jets, general aviation, etc., etc. So it is what it is, and as I say, they have some of the most modern equipment in the world, and they're modernizing their procedures. But you can see the challenges in terms of tracking on-time performance, and particularly when systems congested, and then when you got a disruption like a weather event, a typhoon or a bad rainstorm, you know, affecting an airport, it cascades through and degrades the performance. It happens around Heathrow, it happens in everywhere. So the system, it's not how it's running when things are running well, it's what happens when you put pressure on the system. That's when you realize you're close to where degradation is happens quickly, when you get a shock. So the classic example is Heathrow. It runs at 98% capacity. Any disruption causes massive degradation. In fact, they have to preemptively cancel large amounts. So and China is not just within China. It's domestic, it's international, involving China, and it also everything's connected to everything else. So if you look at some of the when I talked about the flow management issues around the region, China's a party to those discussions as well. In fact, the ICAO regional sub-office that specializes in air traffic management is a small group. It happens to be based in Beijing, not because they're focusing on Beijing, but they China said they'd host that. So it's something that the industry is keen to work with air navigation service providers. ICAO is the lead on most of that, and we and IATA are engaged to provide an airline perspective. Right, others? A few others? What have we got?
Yeah. How concerned is member airlines regarding the situation in North Korea and South Korea, and how robust is processes should, you know, put a supply in the region?
North Korean airspace is generally avoided, but just south of North Korea you've got Seoul and Incheon and Gimpo airports, very busy international hubs. When you're in Seoul, and I've been there several times in the last this year, you're always struck by the disconnect between what you're watching on television and what you're seeing in Seoul. Life in Seoul proceeds as normal, is very calm. And it's hard to think that when you're watching the geopolitical discussions about what President so-and-so says or what et cetera. So the fact is, the missile launches are a concern, because the protocol for missile launches, whoever's launching them, is there is a protocol announcing such activity within a certain time window or date window, and implications for shutting down airspace. So we have some concerns about that, because it blocks out airspace, and after they've done it, they sometimes forget to tell us they've done it, and you don't reopen the airspace, or you reopen some of it but not others. And so there's some discussion about we could do a better job of managing those, you know, military or civil space launches or missile launches, etc. And with a lot more civil space launches with SpaceX and Blue Origin and all the rest of it, I mean, there's some discussion about that, right? We share airspace. So the protocols for that, the problem with North Korea is they don't give advance notice. So that's a concern. So basically, people give it a wide berth all the time. Now, the fact that it spreads over, how far are they firing, what is the likelihood, what's the risk factor, that's got to be factored in. And everyone does their risk assessments, and people's airline routes reflect that. So route decision making about all those different assessments, it's factored in. So it's an issue, but one of many in terms of. We talk about conflicted airspace, avoidance of conflicted airspace. Your regulator may tell you you can't fly within this area crosshatched. They may say you can only fly above this height. I'm not talking North Korea here. They may say above this height's okay, but below's not. But individual airlines will make their own assessments. If I don't use that airspace, what's my alternative? Am I going to go here? What are the risk factors of doing that? Am I adding distance? Does it mean a tech stop? So it's quite logical for different airlines to come to different conclusions, whether they're using this route or that route. There's so many factors to weigh up. Doesn't mean that someone's made the wrong decision. Doesn't mean that someone's taking chances. It's just complex risk assessment. We run a couple of workshops, I think, on this kind of decision making about conflict zones. What are the factors? Where's the intelligence? So it's just one of the many things that gets put into the safety of you. Safe operations agenda, and the industry is very cautious. So, yeah.
Is there any protocol where if North Korea does launch something that there can be notice, you know, and the Japanese or the Americans or whoever, you know, pick up that it's been launched, that aircraft are notified that something's going over to see Japan or Guam?
No, once it's loosed off, it's faster than the response. The military, I'm sure, might have some monitoring capability, and whether they communicate with each other. And when I say the military, I mean foreign military and space surveillance, etc. They seem to be able to tell us a lot about it after it's happened, but the analysis seems to take a while.
Have they changed, you know, routes that they've been using? Are you aware of that? Have airlines actually changed routes as a result of the last few tests?
There have been some, because changing assessments of the size of the area that to the east as to where you'd best avoid. ICAO, I think, has written to North Korea suggesting compliance with ICAO guidelines on prior notice, NOTAMs, etc. That's how it's supposed to work. I say we have cases where that, even where the state in question is trying to do that, it could be done better. And it's something which is attracting attention, because, as I say, the number of other airspace users is increasing. We've got Google balloons flying around at 40,000 feet, providing internet connections in places, drifting around with filing flight plans. We've got more and more satellite launches. The Indians, Americans, everyone's getting into a space launch. It's a growth business. So the mixed users, and then of course at the other end of the scale, drones in airspace, controlled airspace, drones below controlled airspace, but straying into areas they shouldn't near airports. So the whole multiple shared user space of airspace management in the broader sense, there's quite a lot of So ICAO has been having a number of conferences on drones, or whatever they call them, you know, remotely piloted aircraft or whatever. And there's now talks about having global regulation of drones, whereas previously it was thought to be just a national concern. After you've seen the national patchwork emerging and having to evolve quickly as the applications change, it's interesting that now there's a discussion at ICAO about how would we have a global register, what would be the protocols, etc., etc. And on space, it impinges on military, and but the interaction, the question of how do we manage those interactions, allocation.
In terms of safety, has the Kobe steel issue come up at all with airlines or worrying about quality of parts and that sort of thing?
Not that I've heard, but obviously the manufacturers have been alerted, not just of aircraft, but manufacturers have been alerted to the fact they need to check the origins. One of the things about aviation is that everything to do with aerospace manufacturing is traceable. So if you want to know which factory made that rivet and what day, you can trace it back, even for a 20-year-old aircraft. So there's traceability. So you can go back and find out what's where. Then the question is, if it's defective or falsely certified, then what are the implications? Now, you may find it might not meet the specification, but it meets your specification in terms of the requirement. So there's no immediate safety risk. But it's going to create a ripple effect, depending on the quantities involved, the types of materials, etc. But so I've not heard it from the point of view, an airline point of view. I'm sure the regulators are onto it, and if they do identify any particular thing, they'll be quick to issue bulletins, you know, calling for changes or inspections or whatever. That's what happens whenever you get a manufacturing defect. This is unusual. It's a raw material defect being announced long after the fact.